is a regular public school. We have the same money that everybody else has. But to work here is like a dream because I have a lot of my own power to decide what happens when.
I didn't understand everything. And if for a while there was like touch and go. And then when I saw what my daughter was learning, it was not just rote memorizing, but that she was actually learning and retaining what she learned. It was, you know, I could sit back and say, no, this is education.
I was so shy before. I didn't really talk like my opinions. I would always keep it inside. With this school, you can't do that, because with all the activities around, you have to speak up. That's the thing.
What does a great school look like? It means turned on teachers who have the freedom to experiment each and every day. It's about principals who are primarily facilitators and empowerers. And it's a place where parents get involved. It ends up being a place where kids love school. Now let me make it clear. I'm talking about schools that have standards, incredibly high standards in fact. But standards that are met through mutual trust and mutual respect. In this program, we'll be visiting 8 public schools located throughout the United States. These schools represent a growing trend in education toward innovation. Each of these schools has its own individual philosophy. Though their programs are clearly distinctive, they all share a common goal: to involve everyone. Parents, students, principals, and teachers, in helping to shape the direction of that school. Later on, we'll take a look inside some of these schools. But before we do that, let's step back and see how this approach has developed over the years.
In the early 1900s, philosopher John Dewey brought together centuries of thinking in education. He urged educators to treat children as people, not just recipients of information. He called for schools where students would be active participants. One of the first successful experiments was founded in 1924 by Josephine Duveneck, an outspoken pacifist who was deeply committed to education. We'll start our journey with Peninsula, an independent school where children have been enjoying learning for more than 65 years. From preschool through eighth grade, this school, like many other innovative programs, has one overriding goal: for children to believe in themselves, not only as learners, but as individuals. The process begins here in nursery school, where one of the most basic personal skills, learning how to make choices, is first introduced.
Jamie, they're splattering, and Jacob, and Joseph, and Robin, they're splattering the paint. Do you want to get splattered?
No.
If you don't want to get splattered, you maybe ought to be a little farther away. Joseph wants to splatter. How about you, Tolly?
I want to splatter.
It's okay with you.
Teachers help children to recognize what they feel and then encourage them to communicate that.
I didn't hear.
Some splash paint in my yard.
Was that okay with you? Did you tell him about it? Sean? Joseph asked you not to splash paint in his ear. Okay, right.
Children's behavior isn't labeled as good or bad, but we rather look at what's working and what isn't working, and that makes sense to kids. They feel as if they are more and more a part of a predictable environment, one in which what they think and feel has something to do with how it's going to work.
The freedom which can be so exhilarating for children is often challenging for parents to accept.
As a parent, it's a lesson in letting go of the control that you think is important early on in a child's life. And as you go through Peninsula, you learn that control is the least important part of being a parent, and that trusting is the most important part.
The milestones that children pass as they grow are real important to them. And it's very easy when they're small for people to sort of take that for granted.
Laura, let's play paper doll and paper.
Paper doll.
To be noticed is a crucial thing for humans, particularly for children. To not go through life with the sort of anonymity of being just one of many.
Here's Lumpkin. And middle.
Part of holding them on our laps and noticing the things they do that are particularly theirs and responding to their needs comes through in a way of saying to them that they are important, they are individuals, they're growing to be the people that they're going to be, and that that's just fine.
I think it's very important for children to be praised for succeeding at whatever level they currently are. And all of these kids are at different levels.
Very good. Okay. Jimmy. Rhythm names or melody names?
Rhythm.
Okay. Starting with
ta, 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 ta.
Let's start again.
Ta.
Here we go.
Ta, 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 ti, 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 ta.
Great!
When Jimmy was singing, he started in another key from the one that I gave him. And then when it was clear that he wasn't hearing my key, we switched and had him sing in his key, and he sang it perfectly in his key.
Do, 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 re, 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 mi, re, do.
It was not her plump, dark-haired child that lay in the shade, but a thin...
Teachers know that when children enjoy what they're doing, they learn more easily. With this thought in mind, they make sure that reading is a pleasurable activity from the very beginning. Each child learns differently, so reading is introduced in a variety of ways. When children can follow their interests, learning comes naturally. It's easier for them to feel successful when they're choosing the activities. Teaching in this way requires patience and a special understanding which develops over time.
What's this one say?
I mean out.
That says out, and this says... And what's he
Woody
doing?
Has been teaching here for over 50 years.
No two children learn to read exactly the same way. And you have to respect the fact that some children learn almost automatically, and then some of them have a much harder time, and you have to tailor it. Just have to work with each child until you find what is going to be the magic way.
Pin.
Pin. Good.
Parents come in when they can to assist the teachers. Helping out like this is rewarding for parents as well.
One hears over and over again from teachers and parents how they feel they've grown at Peninsula because they had a chance to get in and do work with kids.
In this first grade science class, the students are making their own experiments. The teacher has put out simple household supplies, baking soda, vinegar, iodine, and water, for the children to combine and watch the results.
I want to show you this, guys. Holly, Gillian, David, Galen. Sometimes when you mix the iodine and the different chemicals, you get this layered effect, and you're the guys that showed me how to do this. Yeah. Sometimes you get two or three or four layers, and...
And also this is holding up the water.
That's right. It looks like the iodine is floating on top, doesn't it?
I found out something with the crystal.
Did you?
The crystal is clear.
My role as a teacher here in this setting is to kind of funnel their ordinary interest that's already there. I feel more like I'm guiding them or helping them to see new things rather than showing and telling.
Teaching at Peninsula may look easy, but for me personally, it's a rewarding, fascinating, interesting job that is very, very difficult.
The majority of teachers who come into non-traditional settings do have backgrounds in education. However, very few of them have training in alternative methods. In most schools like this, teachers meet together weekly where they support each other and work as a team to build the curriculum.
It's not meant particularly for elementary school kids. It's meant for middle school and up, high school.
But we can adapt.
I'm sure my kids could do that.
I think they can too. So I'm thinking
teachers have the autonomy to try out their own ideas, much in the same way that the children are trusted to make discoveries for themselves. In this second grade math class, students will be working with colored cubes which represent numbers. By stacking the blocks into groups of 10, they can see how many sets of 10 there are in larger numbers. The tactile experience of handling blocks which they can see and count makes math less abstract and easier to understand.
10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80.
You guys can stand up or sit on the table,
In this kind of activity where the children are actually discovering something for themselves, I think it's important for them to be relatively unfettered by how they sit or where they do it.
Teachers find that giving young children a balance of freedom and responsibility lays the groundwork for independent learning later.
Peninsula gave me the impetus to question and to look further. They just stated problem, and I therefore looked for the answers, and I questioned what the problem was to begin with, and I then went further on that, and that was a valuable experience to say, this is not just the one thing, it's the whole thing, and I have to question each little area in it.
In this third grade writing class, the students are learning to use their imaginations to write creatively. Before they work on their own, the teacher helps them to clarify their ideas. Okay.
The first thing you want to do is make a sentence about some action that took place.
Finding the right words to express their ideas puts demands on the children and can be frustrating.
What would be the result? Having fun? No. Being scared? Result.
The teacher doesn't give them answers. Instead, the students are encouraged to concentrate and think of original ways of writing down what they want to say. The teacher shows the students how to correct their own spelling and grammar errors. They realize that making mistakes is a normal part of learning. When children feel that their ideas are not being judged, they write more freely.
I saw a bow, a sword, and wings, and a torch, and a case of gold. I came to a base. I saw millions of people. One shot at me. I ran and ran. I dropped one of my gloves. I got it. I jumped on this thing. I speeded to an edge.
They found Atlantis, and they love seafood. And one day they decided to go someplace where they had never gone before.
Suddenly I had an idea. If I just wait here, Ryan will come and let me in. So I waited.
As in many other non-traditional schools, students aren't graded. Instead, the teachers send home written evaluations and have conferences with each child's parents.
We made a decision to enroll our daughter in Peninsula. We had, at that point, an expectation that she would be getting math and English, etc. But we weren't getting report cards. And so we assumed that she wasn't obtaining these skills. Well, as it turned out, she went on to a very fine public high school. We immediately found that, in fact, she had obtained these skills, notwithstanding the fact that we hadn't gotten these report cards. There was a different focus. It was a focus on the child.
Making things by hand has always been an important part of the curriculum here. Every afternoon, the children choose from one of several workshops. They have a chance to explore and learn to focus their attention. The school encourages creativity and provides special teachers for these craft shops. Parents help out too by bringing in supplies and used tools to support these programs.
In going into the wood shop, the children get a lot of self-confidence, but they also develop a lot of hand and eye coordination.
That was a little bit too much.
Being able to look at something down there and say, I'm going to hit that right on the head. I'm not going to hit my thumb. I'm going to hit that nail, and you can see it in their eyes. They raise the hammer, and bam. That person really feels good about himself. I mean, there's just a glow that happens, and really, wow, I can handle anything now.
Looks like a table! Well, it might be that. It might not. There. Finished.
Over the years, people have donated looms for this weaving studio. Here, children not only create art, but have a chance to use skills from other classes, such as math.
Weaving is one of the most ancient crafts, and it's also a very mathematical way of thinking. I watch the children learn to think mathematically. They have to do actual figuring out of how much yarn they're going to use. It makes sense why you need to quickly be able to add and subtract, and why you also need to be able to think in those orderly ways.
For children to feel capable is a priority for the teachers. Though their training and classroom styles are very different, they all agree on one thing: the importance of building self-confidence.
Then round them off with some sandpaper so it won't be too sharp. Is that the way you want it, or do you want it a little tighter?
In this metal shop, the teacher passes on his wisdom about how to craft just the right turn on a piece of copper jewelry.
Hold on to that with this hand. Hold it tight. Pull it a little bit. Yeah. Then you stop when you think it's the way you want it.
There's growing evidence that good education may not need to cost more. At this school, the budgeted cost per child is slightly less than the national average for public schools. Parents here represent a wide socioeconomic range. Many of the families work at the school for partial tuition. Students share in maintaining the school, too, by cleaning their own classrooms.
Pick a paper cup, okay?
The family atmosphere develops in many ways, like the carnival the fourth graders create for the youngest kids.
Hey, what a shot.
You did so good, I'll give you a start, okay?
The creating of it, the preparation, the organizing, and the bringing it off, for them to realize the scope of that and to have it happen and succeed at it, this is a wonderful thrill for them.
You want red nose and a white face?
Well, they have an awareness. They have a definite tenderness that they exhibit toward those younger children, and a protectiveness. And they want to have that child succeed and feel good about it. It's a thrill for them to be the person setting up the pins instead of the person aiming.
Okay, roll it again. Roll it.
In this fourth grade class, the morning has been set aside for these children to make masks.
the chance for us to touch each other's faces. I mean, how many opportunities do you have to do that? When they're bent over those tables, looking into those faces of their classmates, and those faces in repose too, which is something they don't usually see, they're just with that face.
It feels neat.
Those guys feel really neat.
Come on.
Everyone helps that person relax. Putting on the plaster, especially around, you know, the nose and the mouth, I mean, that can be a very frightening experience, and I think they all sense that. I think they see themselves there, too. There's a point when they're going to be the one on the table, and that trust will be there and returned. And it's scary a little bit, but they're taking care of each other.
There it goes.
Yay!
Yeah. Nice. All right.
Let me see your eyes. There you go, most of it out.
Find it!
Some of you had a hard time with it, it looked like. Was there a problem with the game that we should look at for the next time we play it?
A couple times I hit it over to the other side of the field. I was on the yellow teams. And they were just all sitting there talking. They weren't even paying attention. And then when it did come over there, they just missed their chance. Mm-hmm.
Class meetings like this fifth grade discussion happen at the end of every day.
How about the teams thing? Did it seem like it was just one team that wasn't playing is what it boils down to?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yesterday when I was playing and I kept on getting hit by Morgan and everything, and then I set out, you know.
I certainly have lots of days when I'm dealing with fights and arguments. We actually look at conflict resolution as part of our curriculum. I find it works better when I teach them ways to listen to each other.
Well, it really annoys me. I always get picked last, no matter what.
Because
you're
the last team. That's not true. I got picked last quite a few times.
Does anyone have an idea of a better way to do team picking?
Actually, I think we should, like, pick the two teams or three teams, whatever we're going to do, once. And then every time after that, you just be on the same team that we play.
There are often a group of kids that are very shy to talk. And one of the things that we work on during the year is making the classroom environment safe enough so that all kids are able to share when they need to.
Feeling acknowledged is important for children. A graduate recalls coming to Peninsula where he could speak openly and felt he was listened to.
I had gotten into a lot of trouble for what was described to me as talking back. Coming to Peninsula, all of a sudden I wasn't talking back. I was in this reciprocal relationship. I was being treated with the respect that adults treated each other with.
In this geography class, the students are learning how to read topographical maps. As in every academic class here, whenever possible, the children will learn by doing. Using the maps as guides, they'll be building clay mountains to scale.
These contour lines, Paige, every inch that you travel up the mountain, I'd like you to take a piece of yarn and go around and try to maintain that same elevation. Elevation meaning how far up off the table you are.
Okay. No, I think it's supposed to be on the table.
Yeah, it's supposed to start from the table.
Inch number two, go.
Okay, number two.
Have you got your first inch?
From the very beginning, teachers here discovered that combining different kinds of activities expanded children's thinking. One of Peninsula's first graduates remembers his own experience vividly.
Mrs. Dubinek was a genius at bringing out our natural skills. That's how she built self-confidence. Finding how we could excel at things. I was very good at math, very good at science. I was not interested in history. I was not interested in learning writing skills. She had a very neat way of showing that those two related, that history of science, history of math, and writing about it were all tied together.
Integrating different disciplines is fundamental to this kind of education. The study of medieval history, for example, begins with library research and writing papers. Then, back in the classroom, the students hear lectures and work together constructing replica models.
What do you want to work on? I think we should work individually.
What are you
going to do? We're making a castle.
Educators find that self-directed groups present an ideal setting for learning, where the students not only present their own suggestions, but they learn to pay attention to each other's ideas.
Done, and we haven't got the inside done. Let's not spend time putting fancy touches on the outside and not doing the inside.
Right. Okay, so I think that we should have the inner curtain itself all to the front.
Sparking children's interest is crucial to this way of learning. For example, this economics class begins with an auction.
Now we're talking your language, aren't we?
$2.
I got $2. Going once, going twice. Sold for $2.
Now let's focus away from the food and onto what just happened here. What's transpired? We had an auction. We stole some things. You bought them. Yeah.
We paid you a lot more than you bought them for.
Okay. Why did you do that?
Peer pressure.
Yes.
Peer pressure, and because you keep on telling us how wonderful it is, and you start to getting kind of hungry, and you say, oh my God, that looks so good, and you have to bid.
You mean you were influenced by my advertising? I did try to influence you, and I did try to influence the prices, and that's one of the principal elements of any economy, is prices. And our economy was stimulated...
Now I could come in, and I could... present all that information, have them read it in a book, test them later. Not very much fun for either one of us. So I'm always looking for alternative ways to present the information so that they'll remember it, so that they'll carry it with them.
Let's do it again.
In the upper grades, the students take more responsibility for their learning. These seventh graders are discussing the past year with their teacher.
You know, I ask you a lot about what goes on, and I really want real feedback. I don't want you particularly worried about whether I will like you or not like you because of something that you say, which sometimes happens. So let's not worry about that. Okay, Toby.
We never had enough creative writing assignments, I don't think. I like creative writing assignments.
I constantly ask for feedback. By the end of the year, in seventh grade, the kids are comfortable enough with me and comfortable enough with themselves as a group to be able to be fairly honest about what's been going on.
You know, I found out this year that it helps when the teachers give it in a way that it's fun, but it's also what I make it. That if I want to say this is going to be a boring assignment, then it's going to be boring. And if I say, oh, this is going to be really fun, most of the times it'll turn out fun.
All right, I'm going to roll down that side now.
When 10:15 came around sometimes and math time comes, I just get this kind of, what you call it, it's like a reaction of, oh no, it's math, I don't want to do math. But then, and I don't know where that's, you know, it's just a kind of a thing you do. And then I say, wait a minute, ease up, math is, there's nothing wrong with it, so go ahead and do your math.
And we're looking at developing children's wisdom rather than just information. And that's a process which is always in process. It doesn't have as finite products. It's not as neatly packaged, but it feels as if there's a vitality there that is very important to education.
The first few years, there was never any question in either of our minds that Vikram is just blossoming and he was a happy kid and this seemed to be the ideal place for the whole family to be. The question started coming when he got to something like fourth grade. And his cousins and other friends whose children are in public schools appeared to be, just started doing homework and had things that he, to a certain extent, didn't seem to know about. And then the question started, is he getting enough academics? After all, the world doesn't end with Peninsula. He has to be prepared for outside world.
In order to address concerns like these, every year recent graduates and a few parents are invited to speak about their experiences with high school.
I was nervous about it myself, and it worked out fine. I didn't need to be so nervous. She's in all advanced classes, and she's doing extremely well. So if the parents can take it easy and not scare the life out of children, they go fine.
Attitudes are also a big difference. I mean, I still find a lot of people who can't, who just, they might not understand something, but they won't go up to a teacher and ask. And I feel that I really learned that, to be comfortable with teachers.
Graduates from alternative programs like Peninsula have learned how to learn. Most of Peninsula's graduates attend a large public high school, Menlo Atherton. There, the majority of them qualify for advanced standing classes.
These kids have self-discipline. They're very mentally mature. They're independent learners. They've been taught. They've been provided the skills to succeed on their own. You can give them a project, a science project. You can give them a paper or a homework assignment, and you can always be sure that their own originality will be reflected in their response.
Before graduating and going on to high school, the eighth graders continue the tradition of leaving a gift for the school. This year, they decided to build a jungle gym.
They've developed a real respect for themselves and are able to extend that to others. And the result is a very mature, optimistic student who has a great sense of his or her own ability to have a real effect on the world.
I'm sort of looking forward to graduating and the whole graduation thing and the night and everything. I also want everything just sort of to stay the way it is. I just want to stay this way. Stay in eighth grade, stay in 13 for years.
Christy McClure.
I just remember standing up on that stage and just thinking, like, all those people here care about me and they're all really happy for me, and just feeling like, you know, they said Victoria's such a nice girl. I've got about 3 seconds to be an eighth grader, and then I gotta go out and be in the world or whatever. Victoria's made me know I'm a good person, and that no matter what happens, that I can come back to Peninsula, and it also gave me the courage that I don't have to come back here, that I know it without coming back here.
Of education has been evolving since the turn of the century in schools like Peninsula. But is it limited to these settings? In recent years, a growing number of public schools have been developing original programs. While each school has its unique character, they all have certain features in common. Innovative curriculum. The staff has the freedom to create original lessons based on the needs of their students. Non-competitive environment. Student progress is evaluated on an individual basis. Shared responsibility. Everyone, including students and parents, has a voice in what happens at their school. In a recent study conducted through the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C., researchers surveyed more than 1,000 schools to identify common elements of successful programs. Working with a colleague from Stanford University, political scientist John Chubb came to the following conclusions.
Our research has established a couple of very important points about school performance. The first is that for a school to be effective, it has to be organized like a team. with a clear set of goals, a mission, a strong principle, and teachers who work together closely as colleagues. We've also established that to get a team-like organization, you have to have a school with control over its own destiny, with autonomy from too much outside control. The final thing that we've established is that autonomy does not come easily to America's schools.
There are schools which have succeeded in gaining autonomy, largely through building relationships of mutual trust with their superintendents and their school boards. We'll now look at eight of these schools, beginning with a dramatic turnaround in New York City. Public School District 4 in East Harlem, New York, encompasses some of the city's poorest sections. In this district, alternatives now outnumber traditional schools. The reason? They work.
This is a district that believes in choice, and it comes out of the fact that we were a school district that was somehow not successful in educating kids.
While he was superintendent, Medina saw the impact of alternatives in his district through a dramatic increase in reading scores. Before this approach was introduced, only 15% of the students were reading at or above grade level. Now that figure is up to 65%.
We have been successful in educating poor, disadvantaged children in this district. The statistics are there, and what they tell us is that somehow kids like coming to school.
At CPE 2, one of the well-established schools here, learning begins with learning how to communicate.
Okay. When I first come to the door, when I ring the doorbell, I can hear my dog running and bumping into the door.
I know it's my house because I hear Katie jumping around.
Katie?
My dog.
Oh, that's your dog's name?
Children hear, they see, they think, they know things. What's important then is to validate what they know to be true. One of the ways in which I validate what children say is by writing down their words. I may write down one word, I may write down an entire sentence, and they see it. They see it in print. I said that. My teacher thinks that what I say is important. It's so important she's writing it down so that other people can see it too.
There's no mystery about what we're doing. All of the educational statistics and all of the research tells us throughout the country as educators that, in fact, those children that have that support are children that come to school ready to learn.
At City Magnet School in Lowell, Massachusetts, all of the students are members of a micro-society. Here, basic skills are taught with the purpose of preparing children to become self-reliant citizens. They run their own marketplace, where they manage businesses and sell handmade products. They can also take out business loans from a full-service bank, where they deposit their earnings in money called mogans.
It's just so, you know, vibrantly different, or it's just so interesting, really, because the teachers don't tell you a fact and you write it down and forget about it. They'll keep reminding you and reviewing you, and you use it. You actually use what you learn.
You are the ones who found the mistake.
All of the basics are integrated into the activities of the micro society. For example, math skills are taught in the bank, where percentages and interest rates have real meaning.
When we teach, it isn't stockpiling knowledge. It's also utilization of that knowledge, which makes the student feel, I'm learning for a purpose.
Discipline is not handed down from adults to children here. Students share in that responsibility. They write and amend their own laws, and when those laws are broken, they use their legal system to bring cases to trial.
What date did this happen?
September 30th.
Can you please tell the judge and the jury exactly what happened?
All I saw was Lauren Morphy push John into the lockers and punch him because I was talking to Mark the whole time, and when I turned around, that's what I saw.
You didn't see John?
Our children have ownership of the program, and having this ownership provides them with more incentive to learn.
At Clara Barton in Minneapolis, Minnesota, the curriculum is built on the understanding that every child has his or her own individual learning style. This school, winner of a President's School of Excellence Award, works with children's differences by developing lessons which involve all of the senses.
That's the heart. It's another almost part of a lung.
Someone's lungs are wilting.
These are the kidneys, I think, or the...
Most of what happens in traditional schools is about 80% visual. Consequently, those children who are not visual, those children who are auditory, or those children who are tactile kinesthetic are really left out of the picture. We try very hard to plan our lessons and plan our units so that children have a visual component, an auditory component, and a tactile kinesthetic component in almost everything that they do.
So we have rectangles and squares.
In this math class, students are taught geometric shapes by using their bodies as lines and angles.
You need to make an octagon, all right? An eight-sided figure with six people. So let's see how you can solve that problem.
Okay.
There are many, many people who learn best. You know, the more their body is involved, the more their muscles and sort of every fiber of their being is involved in something, the better they're going to learn it.
Okay, kids in the back. This group had an interesting solution with, they tried and tried and tried a lot of different things, and they finally came up with using their hands. So we have a small octagon in here with one line, two lines, three lines, four lines, five lines, six lines, seven lines, eight lines. There we go, you got it, all right.
At Davis Alternative in Jackson, Mississippi, the school is structured so that, in addition to learning academic skills, students also learn the skill of working together.
Today we're going to be working in our cooperative groups again, and every person who's in the group has a job to do. Our task for today is finding words in the capital letters in sentences. We have four jobs for our group today. Happy talker, checker, teller, writer.
Given our diverse population, racially and economically, it is not enough simply to organize the setting, but we do in fact plan for cooperative interaction. We're teaching a way of living and working together where they take on roles, where they learn to support one another, to encourage one another, and work to a common good.
At Tanglewood Open Living School in Jefferson County, Colorado, the program evolves from the children's interests. Students select projects and topics which intrigue them, and then study those. As they work on the subjects they've picked, they're shown how to apply academic skills.
How are you going to correlate the horses and ponies with mathematics?
We'll make graphs of how many there are.
Very good. Okay, for art.
Another way the school supports children's interests is by helping them find internships and apprenticeships in the local community. Tanglewood students choose their own jobs and then volunteer 30 hours over several months. Instead of money, they receive class credit, on-the-job experience, and a chance to contribute.
A major need that is not being addressed in general that we have to address is the students' need to be needed, to offer something, not to just be the receiver. Can't do that sitting in a classroom taking tests all the time. So all of those things, I think there's a movement in the society now for service as a part of what we expect. People don't know how to do it. I think alternative schools have been doing it historically for a long time.
I'll see if you can make it do weird things in the air.
Tanglewood's apprenticeship program began 14 years ago. Brian Rothfuss, a ninth grader, chose to do his apprenticeship as a guide in Denver's Children's Museum.
You learn a lot doing this, though. You learn what not to do, what to tell the kids when they're doing something.
Hey, stay off the carpet. You gotta walk on the wood, okay? Stand on the wood.
a lot of times it impresses people. And I get a lot of questions like, shouldn't you be in school? I say, no, this is for school. I get credit for this.
The apprenticeship experience they often feel is one of the things that contributed most to their education, because they've gone out and done something important that was seen as important in the world outside of school.
At Bramin Parks in Cambridge, Massachusetts, everyone in the school community becomes an active participant. The curriculum is developed by the teachers themselves, using discussions more than lectures. Throughout the school, parents are participants too, and give what time they can to help out.
Parents do contribute really significantly to this school, not only whether it's fundraising or coming into the classrooms, but it also gets back to their kids, in the sense that their kids see that their parents are really concerned about their education.
The caring environment created by parents and teachers becomes an example for the students themselves. As part of their schoolwork, older students are given opportunities to tutor the younger ones.
Boat. Oh, what vowel is that? Good. What are you doing?
Using a board game, Brett, who's a seventh grader, is helping these students recognize vowels. In the same spirit, she knows she'll be able to ask for help from her classmates.
Yes, but it's one more number.
Math is not one of my favorite subjects, but if I had to have a math class anywhere, I think it would be in Steve's room. Because it's, you know, because, I mean, if you need help, he says, oh, I don't do one-on-one. Go get help, and you can go sit with your friend and help each other.
Yeah. You get it?
Yeah.
Would you, like, mind sharing this with us? But listen. Okay,
I like students to solve problems as a group. I want them to argue with each other. I don't want them to try to do a problem in isolation, but to share information.
Okay, and they're all the same color. Okay, I have one color.
Everyone brings their individuality to this school, especially the teachers, who have the freedom to develop their own classroom style.
You really got to be somewhat creative about it. I think you really have to close your textbook and teach.
At Central Park East High School in East Harlem, New York, the teachers organize the program so that every student will develop a strong sense of self-respect. Achieving this goal for the students begins with the respect the teachers show for each other. At their weekly meetings, there's an open exchange of ideas as they go over their problems in working out their classes and talk about what they're teaching.
The first time we tried teaching a book in common, and it was fun because we come in the morning and talk each day about what happened the day, you know, what happened in your class, what happened in your class. So we were really able to share the process when it was happening, and it was nice.
The secondary school has been very successful in retaining its students. So it very clearly is not within the norm of what's happening in the rest of the city, and that is that in communities like ours, it's estimated that almost 60% of the kids drop out. That's not happening in our school.
In this social studies class, students are in charge. Each student chooses a topic and does background reading, then leads a class discussion. This week, the subject is drugs.
Do you think that more people are going to start using drugs?
Yes.
Yeah. Why?
Giving one student the responsibility for leading the group is probably one of the first steps toward allowing that student to feel as if he or she has power. The goal of the school is to empower kids in a way that will allow them to become successful adults.
In this atmosphere, teenagers feel safe and will talk honestly about what's on their minds.
Go ahead. Continue.
People that want the drugs could go out and kill somebody easily. And rob them, and not just rob one person to get the money like that for the drugs, yeah. Rob more and more people.
They know that there's crack out there. They know there's heroin out there. They know that there are people who live in the same building with them that use these drugs. They know that in their day-to-day lives, they're struggling against falling prey to these very drugs.
All the while during that discussion, most of you kept returning to the same issue about who is going to be affected by this drug, by the change in drug laws.
Kids.
At the end of their class session, the students decide to write a letter to their congressman, letting him know some of their feelings about drugs.
Can we get this translated into Spanish?
Yeah.
Can we get this translated into Spanish? So that we'll have it in two languages.
Go ahead, say it.
That school now is an oasis for learning. It's a school that regardless of the surroundings and regardless of even the facility itself, the way it looks in some places, it's a school where kids learn and where we know that those kids are going to be responsible adults once they graduate.
The foundation for what we've been seeing is a focus on human values in our schools. There's a growing appreciation for the importance of this emphasis in today's changing world. Learning begins with learning how to communicate. Academic content has meaning when students are involved. When the curriculum is responsive, it meets a wide range of different learning styles. Mutual respect develops when children work together. Students are eager to contribute to the community. Everyone can be an integral part of the school. Self-respect grows when students take on real responsibilities. Providing real options for children within a traditional system of education is a challenge. The New Orleans Free School is a testament to the commitment of its founder and principal, Bob Ferris.
One, two, three. That's the hardest one.
Since the 1960s, Ferris has kept his idealism alive, struggling for the right to create and carry out his vision.
We wanted to demonstrate that you could, in fact, in a public school, do it differently and be very successful.
Okay, anyone interested in a newsletter?
Bob Ferris is especially proud of the school's choice program, which offers exciting extracurricular activities during the school day, along with the regular academic schedule. Students sign up for an activity they'll attend each afternoon that week. Choices range from photography to sign language.
W-X-Y-Z. Now I say my ABCs, tell me what you think of me.
What we're fighting for is, you know, not just to be different for different sake, but it is to create a very distinctive, very unique program.
The district office has been cautious in approving this approach. For example, Ferris met with opposition when he chose not to give letter grades. However, the results have shown that a non-competitive environment is supportive of learning.
She put a comma and she found it's a good way to write a compound sentence, real good.
Over the last 10 years, students here usually score in the top 20% of the district. Administrators have begun to appreciate the value of programs like these.
As I assess myself personally relative to alternative schools, I find that I've grown tremendously. It hasn't been easy. I guess it's through working with staff members who feel very committed. And I think I have to attribute much of my growth as an educator to those people because they opened my eyes and I found out that we don't always have to do the exact same things or teach the same way or have it at the same time for boys and girls to learn.
The real program development has to come at the school level. If we could move our school system towards encouraging schools to really be unique or distinctive, you're going to heighten the commitment because it's something the people there are creating and love and want to nurture.